It's my great pleasure to be able to introduce Dr. Franz Córdova, the director of the National Science Foundation. Franz has had a very distinguished and varied career, starting with getting a Ph.D. at Caltech in 1979. You can't get much more distinguished than that. She then joined Los Alamos Lab, the Space Astronomy and Astrophysics Group, and then held a number of leadership positions in academia and public service, including the head of the Department of Astronomy and Astrophysics at Penn State, NASA Chief Scientist, Vice Chancellor of Santa Barbara, Chancellor of Riverside, President of Purdue University, which I learned last night includes all the campuses of Purdue, and Chair of the Board of Regents of the Smithsonian Institution. She started at the National Science Foundation in 2014. And I want to take this opportunity to also point out that Franz is a great friend of Caltech. And she, because she really appreciated the mentorship she got from faculty here, she established a number of prizes. And we've just awarded those prizes, and I'd like to announce them here. They are students who are nominated by their advisors for having done outstanding research. And David Austin, who works with Professor Jason Alessia on theoretical studies of topological phases of matter and quantum computation, was awarded the Tom Tombrello Prize. And Tombrello was a good friend and mentor to Franz. Michael Eastwood, who works with Greg Hallinan, building and commissioning the long wavelength array at the Owens Valley Radio Observatory, was awarded the Neugebauer Prize. And Sarah Gossin, who works with Alan Weinstein on modeling dynamics of core collapse supernovae, in particular their detectability in gravitational waves by LIGO, was awarded the Garmeyer Prize. And I would like, after the lecture, if the awardees are in the room, them to come up and get their picture taken with Dr. Córdova. So without further ado,
thank you.
I'd like to introduce Dr. Franz Córdova.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Fiona, and thank you for your leadership at Caltech. This morning, I had the privilege of having breakfast with those three prize winners. And just in case they're not in the room, we did take a picture of ourselves in front of the Christmas tree at the Athenaeum. And after hearing from them what they're up to, what their research is about, and what their aspirations are for their futures, I also shared with them some private stories about Garmeyer and Neugebauer and Tombrello. And so I won't be giving those stories here, but I just explained why I thought they were such fabulous mentors. And really, the reason I'm here and have had, in my view, an interesting, wonderful life is because of the support I got from Caltech. From the time that they accepted me as a graduate student and then mentored me throughout my graduate student career, and then afterwards being close friends, that there's just a very unusual collaboration between faculty members and students here, and real genuine support in whatever field you're in. And I just felt that very strongly. And so my message in creating these supplemental fellowships was to say thank you. And you know, what better way to say that than to invest in the next generation? And so any of you who are students here, just please know that your faculty are always there for you, and you just have to ask or look pathetic as I did, and then they'll come to your rescue. Well, it's a real pleasure to be back here at Caltech, and just yesterday I had many meetings with students and all sorts of different groups, and we discussed a lot of things, had great question and answer sessions, and this morning just walking from the Athenaeum to Kirchhoff and passing Ricketts and Dabney and Page House and all those places where I knew students, and bringing back the old memories. And of course, Downs Lauritsen, where I was a graduate student. It was terrific. In fact, just to share with you one story about Downs Lauritsen. So I was on the fourth floor, And that was the same floor where, on the other side of the elevators in the Lauritsen part, were the likes of Richard Feynman and Murray Gell-Mann and others, some of whom actually put et al. On their doors as their names. So I thought that was odd, especially because one of them actually won the Nobel Prize years later. But it was an unusual place, and I think you all know what being at an institution that is small, just how close and supportive and conducive to research that really is. Well, I appreciate this opportunity to outline NSF's vision for the future and our commitment to critical partnerships that help us work together to push forward the frontiers of science. So I've divided my talk into three parts. First, some about NSF and its background, just in case you don't know it already. And then the situation that we find ourselves in today, and it's especially in a funding sense, and what our challenges are. And then finally, opportunities that we see before us, and especially involving partnerships and what we call the Big Ten. So as you know, NSF works every day to support basic or fundamental research. So that's very upstream research that engages the scientific curiosity of hundreds of thousands of scientists, educators, and students across the country. NSF-supported research has had tremendous real-world impact. I'll talk a little bit about that. We believe that we enrich the lives of millions of people around the world, including everyone here who uses all kinds of devices that started with an NSF grant to somebody. For more than two centuries, our nation has encouraged a climate in which scientific and engineering discoveries have adapted to new changes and continue to thrive, and NSF has been one important expression of that commitment. So our roots were, in, like many of the federal agencies, in national security. Vannevar Bush, who was then scientific advisor to President Roosevelt, was head of an office called the U.S. Office of Scientific Research and Development during World War II. And he wrote what is probably the most enduring science policy document of the last century. And I encouraged students when I met with them yesterday who are really interested in science policy. It kind of starts there. And many of the things that Vannevar Bush talked about, especially the need to support basic research, the need for the federal government to do so, and the need to support STEM education and outreach, are still very fresh today. And other things that he talked about as far as the progress of science and basic and applied have very much changed up and gotten mixed up some all too good effect since then. But his document was the first to really unambiguously spell out the importance of basic research to discovery and innovation. And he pointed to wartime applications in security and health as evidence. So the report called for sustained government investment in the brightest people with the most innovative ideas. And NSF was the answer to this call, his proposed answer, a federal agency that was designed to support discoveries and discoverers. So it was approved by Congress finally in 1950 and continues today as an independent agency. So we're part of the executive branch. We're part of the White House executive branch. We have an extraordinary mandate, which is on this slide, to promote the progress of science, to advance the national health, prosperity, and welfare, and secure the national defense. NSF has tried not only to fulfill that every minute since 1950, but has also helped shape what the future progress of science might look like. So here's NSF by the numbers. It's the only federal agency that is dedicated purely to supporting basic research and education across the spectrum of science and engineering. So everything except biomedical, which lead to NIH, and of course more downstream applied research we do, so across many domains that I'll mention in just a minute. So our proposed budget for FY17 is $8 billion, and unless somebody has gotten some news out of Washington this morning, I think we're closed for business as of midnight tonight, so, but we need for Congress to pass a continuing resolution. We're on a continuing resolution that expires at midnight, and we need another one or the government will be closed. So we also operate very, very efficiently. I think many organizations would be surprised to see what a low overhead we are. Namely, 93% of our budget goes right out the door to support research and education. And 85% of that goes to universities. And the remainder goes to small business, innovative research projects with startups and foundations. But most of it, universities are really our big client. So this snapshot of NSF by the numbers illustrates what we do, what we spend, whom we invest in. You can see, for example, that every year we get 50,000 proposals. So if your proposal isn't accepted immediately, then please try again, because we can only accept 20% of the proposals we receive. And you see that one of our metrics that's on this slide is that we've supported the research of 223 Nobel Prize winners, including every US winner of the economic prize in honor of Nobel. NSF champions research, as I said, across all disciplines, and you can see them listed here: biological sciences, engineering, math, and physical sciences, and that includes astronomy and physics and chemistry and statistics and math and material sciences. We support computer and information science, cyber infrastructure, the geosciences, including environmental sciences, ecology, polar sciences, and social and behavioral and economic sciences. We fund research on STEM education and development of the STEM workforce, and we fund a lot of graduate student fellowships and undergraduate research experiences. We also fund informal science education, including citizen science. NSF is a major funder of academic basic research, as you can see on this slide some examples. While other agencies provide mission-directed research in fields like health or defense, we're uniquely poised to fund the fundamental research that they depend on. So some students from the Caltech Y that I met with yesterday are about to go to Washington, D.C. to meet with other agencies. They asked, what are the differences between those agencies like DARPA, ARPA-E, NASA, et cetera. And we fund research that is more upstream, that develops pilot projects, prototypes that they can then take more into application. We're the major funder of universities in critical fields like math and biology and environmental sciences. As you can see from this slide, 82% of the basic research for academic computer science comes from NSF. So the next two slides illustrate the breadth of NSF research. And we'll fill this in here. So let's start with the scale from 10 to the minus 8th to 10 to the plus 8th meters. So NSF directorates, we call them directorates in the university, they've been called colleges, that operate in this regime here that I depict, include biology, which investigates the microbiome, the brain, plants, and humans, and is building a continental scale observatory for ecological observations. Computer science does work on a scale from microchips to high-performance supercomputers. Engineering research works in nanotechnology and engineering biology and spans the range from advanced manufacturing to continental-scale electric grids. And in geoscience supports ocean research with ships, submersibles, and large instrumented platforms to understand continents and the interior and atmosphere of our own planet and others. Social and behavioral and economic sciences, and we're one of the very few places that funds that research, studies you and me in action and in context. And education research has an emphasis on how individuals and groups learn. In this image, we broaden the scale of NSF's exploration. It goes from 10 to the minus 24th meters to 10 to the plus 24th meters. That is from the scale of the neutrino to the scale of the supercluster of galaxies in Virgo. Note the 100 hertz gravitational wave at 3 times 10 to the 6 meters, and I'll say a little bit more about that later. From neutrinos at one end of the scale to the horizon of the observable universe at the other, from the more recent discoveries of the Higgs boson to the detection of gravitational waves, from discoveries of molecules in space to defining the shape of the Milky Way. These are all areas mined by NSF-funded researchers in math and physical sciences. So to explore this wide regime, we host a suite of ground-based observatories, which we call multi-messenger, in the sense that some instruments detect photons, some detect charged particles, or neutral particles, like neutrinos, and some detect gravitational waves. These facilities are globally distributed. They include the Atacama Large Millimeter Submillimeter Array, or ALMA, the Large Synoptic Survey Telescope, LSST, and Gemini South Telescope. All three of those are in Chile. The Jansky Very Large Array in New Mexico, and the Gemini North Telescope, and the Daniel K. Inouye Solar Telescope, which would be the world's largest solar telescope, in two different peaks in Hawaii. Multi-messenger observatories also include the high-altitude water Cherenkov, or HAWK, which is a gamma-ray and cosmic ray observatory near Pueblo, Mexico, the largest neutrino detector ice cube at the South Pole, the advanced LIGO facilities in Washington State and Louisiana, and contributions to the CERN detectors, ATLAS and CMS, in Geneva, Switzerland. And almost all of those have international participation and or are coordinated with other US agencies. And I'll give you just two examples. ALMA in Chile has received more than $1 billion in investments from a broad coalition, including Europe, East Asia, led by Japan, and Chile. ALMA is providing a testing ground for theories of star birth and stellar evolution and solar system formation. And the Large Spectroscopic Survey Telescope, which is presently under construction in Chile, has a huge camera that's being furnished by the Department of Energy to the tune of about $170 million for the instrument alone. This slide further illustrates NSF's global presence. In polar research, NSF leads the US Antarctica program, which manages three stations there, including the one at the South Pole, and a lot of scientific facilities for astronomy, earth sciences, and physics. On the world's ocean, the NSF Ocean Observatory Initiative is a network of platforms and sensors. NSF also has a fleet of ongoing research vessels that explore the world's oceans. We have a lot of programs distributed worldwide, as you can see on this map, for international research experiences for students, like the Graduate Research Opportunities Worldwide program and the International Research Experiences for Undergraduate Students. So international collaboration makes these NSF-supported efforts to answer the most fundamental questions about nature and our universe possible. This is a slide which shows that our presence and our impact, like our presence, is also global. It shows just a small sample of the amazing things for which NSF support was instrumental. Our history is replete with transformative discoveries, many that we use without consciously thinking about them every day. 3D printing, we gave the first grant for 3D printing when people thought it was too high risk to invest in. That was to a UT Austin researcher. We funded the algorithm used by the FCC, Federal Communication Center, to auction portions of the wireless spectrum, and that's a $60 billion industry today. We funded Charlie Towns and others for the development of the maser, which led to the laser. We funded the chemistry of palladium that's led to both numerous pharmaceuticals and pesticides. We funded the first grants for gene editing. Jennifer Doudna, when she talks about her support and that of others for gene editing, always remarks that if it weren't for the initial NSF grant to get her started and make the whole thing seem plausible, she would not have gotten the subsequent funding for that. If you can't imagine a world without Doppler radar, without the cataloging of languages, the decoding of genomes, and without Google, you can thank NSF for supporting its two graduate student founders, Sergey Brin and Larry Page, one with the graduate fellowship and the other funded as part of the Digital Libraries Project. So as you can see, I'm quite proud that we can look back retrospectively and see that our funding, sometimes a very high risk research that people didn't really know where the applications were going to end up, has had transformative breakthroughs and benefits. So how can we do even better? Well, we've been, for the past couple of decades actually, trying to fund programs that accelerate what we call from discovery to delivery. And we think that this is a science in itself, the acceleration of translation. So funding translation and funding everything up to including the startup of new businesses has been a goal of ours for some time. This slide shows how translational research programs of NSF's Division of Industrial Innovation and Partnerships works. And so again, we're very upstream of the whole cycle from discovery to delivery, but it's an important part of the upstream process, because unless you really get to develop proof of concept and see what the potential markets and benefits of research is going to be, then you really don't have a chance of making a go of it as far as developing a business out of it. So I want to highlight in this area just three of the kinds of things we do. And then also mention that for a long time, and just this past couple of weeks, we celebrated actually in the memory of Eric Block, who as NSF director in the early 90s created the engineering research centers. And that was kind of the start of our getting more involved in translational activities. And Eric started those engineering research centers, of which Caltech has had a few over the course of the last 30 years. Well, this slide shows the three programs I just want to briefly mention that are so important in this domain of acceleration. One is the Small Business Innovative Research Program, which exemplifies how we create models of innovation and then help them to grow and increase the scale of their impacts. So the focus is on technology innovation, and NSF was the first agency to fund this program in the late 1990s. We proposed it, and it was written into law in 82. Our initial investment was only $1 million. Today it's $120 million. And today, 11 federal agencies support SBIR and its twin sister, STTR, which is at universities, getting involved in this kind of translation development. And the total investment on the federal government's part is $2.5 million today. The Industry University Collaborative Research Centers is like the engineering research centers. One could argue that it's more use inspired, it has definite targets, and it's leveraged by a factor of 10 to 1 by industry participation. It's a model for promoting partnerships with industry, and it benefits both industry and the university by focusing on the basic research that are specifically designed to meet the needs of industry partners. Our first program here was in 1973, and today we have 80 such active centers around the country with partners from 225 universities and a large number of private companies. A case study of three of these centers in three different industry sectors showed that for every dollar that NSF invested, the estimated value of the impact was $64. So I think you'll agree that's very high leverage. So those are our two programs that we've been doing for a while and doing very well. One that we created more recently, and maybe some of you in this room are involved in, is what we call our Innovation Core program. It just started up in 2011. And it is a really good example of how we're facilitating downstream development of technologies and processes from our NSF-sponsored fundamental discoveries. It's designed to create a public-private network of scientists and engineers and innovators and business leaders and entrepreneurs to accelerate the strength of our national innovation ecosystem. It has a curriculum that was first developed at Stanford University that ensures that students do market-based research to determine the readiness of their research for commercialization. As you know, not every discovery has a market and is ready for commercialization. And I find it very interesting as I go to different campuses and I meet the students and faculty that are involved in this, how it's really transformed how they think about the potential impact of their discoveries. Caltech is part of the Southern California I-Corps node, which was established only in 2014, and it includes USC and UCLA. And that I-Corps node has trained more than 150 engineering teams in corporate and university environments in Southern California. And it includes not only Southern California, but other countries as well. To date, NSF I-Corps researchers have created more than 320 companies, and it's just a real thrill to see young people stand up and say that they are now the CEO of a new company using this kind of methodology and instruction and hands-on sort of learning how to do market-based research. And they've raised more than $93 million. These companies have, these startups, in follow-on funding. So it's been a real success, so much so that it's been copied by two other agencies, the NIH and the Department of Energy, other states like Ohio and Pennsylvania, and other countries, namely Mexico and Ireland. So it's, for a program that's only 5 years old, it's having a great impact. So having looked back now and just shown you kind of globally what NSF is up to, and I think you'll agree there's a big range of things there, I want to turn to part two, which is the challenges of the present. And I want to look very briefly at the national and global R&D spending picture, because that's the climate that I'm involved in. I used to wonder when I was a graduate student, faculty member and so on, why an NSF director just mostly talked about the budget. And now that I am one, I mostly talk about the budget. Because as you saw, we give most of our money away. We have very small overhead. And if the universities that do all this great research benefit by our acquiring more to give them and to invest in them. And so that's what the role really is. So NSF is supposed to judge good research coming in the door and decide which projects. As I said, we can't nearly fund all of them. And so we have a big elaborate merit review process to do that. And the other role is to make sure that we really talk about the benefits of basic research. And that's something you can all engage in and why it needs more investment. So this shows us kind of a rather cautious picture. On the right-hand side is a plot of total R&D spending by federal and industry sources. And you can see that industry and the total R&D has far surpassed a long time ago, since 1980, when we were both at about $70 billion overall, government spending, which is nearly level. And I would note that most of that R&D is D, when industry is concerned. Very little of it is for the R part of that, applied research, and vanishing little for basic research. So for basic research, the plot is on the left, and you note the difference in scales, okay? That's, you know, much different. And there, the federal government is the big player. As I said, industry really invests very little in basic research. Some types of industries are even prohibited from them, from that. And you see that the federal government is the big player, and you see that it's really leveled off in its basic research investment since the beginning of the decade. And so that's the scenario that we're really struggling with. At the same time that we're trying to broaden participation in science, we don't have more money to invest in the new participants. Most of that increase that you see there on basic research was because of the NIH doubling. If you want to see what's NSF's situation is, that's on this slide here. You see that early on, from the 1980s up to the present decade, we were on a 5% average growth. But we've really, really leveled off and since then, and that includes our ARA funding of a few years ago when we had the economic downturn. So it's really, for all intents and purposes, flat. You'll also notice that if we had continued on that 5% trajectory, we'd be somewhere north of $2 billion more, which, interestingly, is exactly the number shown on this plot that we believe we leave on the cutting room floor of excellent proposals. So what are we looking at here? These are the declined proposals for 1 year, fiscal year 2015, the last we have the full data for. And what you see is plotted the cumulative requested amount versus the average reviewer rating, okay? So where excellent is over to the far left, score of 5, and poor to the far right. And the average award rating, as noted there in red, is 4.2. So those are proposals that are between the very good rating and excellent rating. And mind you, these are done by peer review that includes a number of reviewers, so not just by one person alone. So the number of declined proposals that is at or above the score of the average award is amounts to a requested amount of $1.7 billion. And if you go all the way to the very good score, that would total $4 billion. So let's just say that very good is very good, okay? And we should be funding very good proposals, or that are rated very good to excellent. Then that's just billions of dollars every single year that we simply don't have enough funding to invest in. And these numbers don't even count the numbers of people who don't submit their good ideas because they're discouraged by the funding statistics, okay? And so that's loads and loads more. So we think this is a very serious situation. And it comes at a time, shown on this slide, when the rest of the world is really investing. So they've all taken a page from our playbook, and other countries are really accelerating their investment in research and development. So on the left-hand side, what you see is not all countries, but some of the developed countries in the OECD. This is a plot from them. Every line there is a different country. The big red line that's marked US is us. And you see that we're in the middle of the pack. We're very flat. What is plotted here is not total monies for research and development. It's what we call R&D intensity. So it's the ratio of the money for R&D divided by the gross domestic product. So that's a way of normalizing things. So though the U.S. remains in the forefront of dollars funded, other nations are fast approaching us, investing heavily as never before. China, for example, is now the second largest research and development performer worldwide, just behind the US. And at this pace, it will surpass the US in research and development intensity within the decade. And we also see on the right-hand side that the US has slipped steadily downward from second place to 10th place in research intensity among OECD nations. And so this should concern all of us that that we simply haven't kept up with the kinds of investments we were making before. And even more importantly, the other nations of the world who are now launching things like quantum communication satellites and really developing a lot of technologies, new technologies on their own recognizance are already becoming formidable competitors in the research world. So I hope I've shown you in this part two of my remarks that that the constrained funding for research is holding us back, and the situation is not looking brighter at the moment. So how can we address this need to fund projects across the spectrum of science and engineering and continue to be globally first rate? So one way is by creating effective partnerships. And in this slide, I illustrate just very simply the different kinds of partnership that NSF is furthering. And one of the goals of my week here in California is to talk with foundations and others in industry about what they invest in research and what we do and how we can be even deeper and better partners. And so I spent some time, for example, in the Bay Area meeting with various industries, mostly in the high-tech information technology world, and with several foundations about where we can be good partners. And we'll do the same thing here. So this is engagement that leverages and augments our capability to increase the translation from basic research to innovation and onto startups. And we think that this renewed emphasis on partnerships with foundations and industry is very exciting. I think a lot of great work is being done, for example, in neuroscience and the brain. Wonderful new partnerships have developed, but it's simply not enough. It doesn't cover the waterfront of research. It doesn't cover some of the areas that are more esoteric and more basic that industry doesn't even know that it's really going to need in the future. So if the U.S. is going to address our challenges like water and food security, climate change, cybersecurity among them, that we're going to have to invest in our own science and engineering ecosystem. And we really believe that the government plays a key role and a unique one in providing critical long-term investments that private industry alone can't sustain. So why do we embrace this challenge? Because we try to answer the really hard questions. Our mission is to search for truth, to explore the unknown, despite insurmountable obstacles. We face, we like to believe that we finance high risk, high reward projects, even when there isn't a clear prospect of success, because we want to let loose people's imagination and curiosity, people of all ages and backgrounds in this search. So I want to start on the third part of my talk with one of the highest risk, highest reward things that NSF has invested in recently, and this is one that should be known to all of you because Caltech's own investment was so great in this research. The Advanced Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, or LIGO, is a wonderful example of NSF's unique capability to fund breakthrough science. LIGO is one of the largest and most ambitious projects ever funded by the NSF, and we showed remarkable persistence. We hung in for 40 years funding gravitational wave observational science. The result of this long-term commitment can be seen in these two facilities, the LIGO facility in Louisiana on the top right there, and then on the bottom, the one in Louisiana, Washington State, Louisiana. In those observatories, a lot of researchers of all kinds worked with very high performance technology and high performance computers around the nation, doing simulations of black hole and neutron star mergers using the equations of general relativity. It was my privilege to sit with a number of students yesterday, both from the numerical relativity group and then separately from the LIGO group, about their roles in this research. And this also included, of course, an extended network of researchers in 15 countries making really seminal contributions to hardware, software, and human capital. So that decades-long investment paid off earlier this year when LIGO scientists announced that they had observed gravitational waves, confirming the prediction of Albert Einstein's 1915 general theory of relativity. And of course, we had other evidence, including the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar and so forth for gravitational waves. But what is additionally very special, besides discovering them here on Earth and feeling the Earth jiggle ever so slightly, was that we have a real observatory now. And I think you all know that at least two have been published, such detections, which makes the O in LIGO prominent now. It is an observatory. And phase two just started up last week, and hopefully that will have good news soon, because they are even more sensitive than the original LIGO. So there were a lot of celebrations that occurred, celebrating that we are here at the right moment in history to sample a wave that started 1.3 billion years ago and detect it. And here's what the students at Georgia Tech University had to say about it. So going forward, LIGO's success is going to be a key building block of our plan for the future. And so what is that future? What could that look like? So this is where I want to spend a couple of minutes, as the third part of my talk, is looking ahead our big ideas. So first, let me say that NSF is not used to putting signposts to new frontiers into the future. That's not been our thing. We have always been a bottoms-up agency. We take in proposals, proposals that are unsolicited, proposals in certain areas that are solicited. As I said, we get 50,000 a year. We have a great merit review process that's emulated worldwide to evaluate what could be the potential impact of those. And then we fund them and stay with them as long as needed. So what we did this past year was something unusual for NSF, and that is we had a retreat in-house, but all the in-house people attending, which were the scientific leadership, and Joan Farini Monday, who's here with me, just raise your hand, Joan, because she leads our education division. It's a very important part and represents the leadership of those folks coming together. And they brought community input and the input of their program officers with them. And we sequestered ourselves off-site for a few days, and we asked the question that what kind of science do we fund somewhat, but only lightly, because we don't have enough investment right now to do more, but has huge breakthrough potential for the future. Where are the new frontiers in science that NSF is uniquely suited to invest in? So these are not, if we were at NASA, we have different set of big ideas, DOE, NIH, and so on. But these are ones that we feel that our agency should really be stepping out on and investing in. And they do all require future investment. So they are, it's not, we can make incremental progress, as we're doing, in these areas. But in order to really go to the next revolution in these areas, we are going to need future investment. So let me just recite what they are in just a couple of words about them. So navigating the new Arctic. Lots of changes happening there. I'll talk more about that in a second. I just want to enumerate them so you know what's on, what the big 10 look like. Harnessing the data revolution, that's what do we do with all these big data, and how do we mine it for science and scientific discoveries, and what kind of new computer architectures are required. The human technology interface presents all sorts of opportunities. Technology shapes what we do, how we live and learn. We should in turn shape technology to benefit society. And it's such a big frontier, what with gene editing, genetically modified everything, that we thought we would start with the future of work. What is work going to look like tomorrow and 10 years from now? And because of artificial intelligence and machine learning, deep learning, how are jobs going to be transformed? How do we make work better? How do we make work inclusive and that machines can collaborate alongside of humans? Understanding the Rules of Life. This addresses the many mysteries in biological sciences, namely, how do we go from the genome and its environment that the genome is exposed to the phenotype? How does that, what is phenotypic emergence? What does that mean? And how do those, the rules of life, show, if we could uncover them, how do they reveal more about that mystery? And we think that that's going to affect everything from plants and, for example, photosynthesis, relatively inefficient process. How does that process really work so that we can use technology to improve it and make it even as efficient as solar cells? But it means a lot for the world's food supply. And there are many other areas, including the search for life elsewhere, that that would affect. And then the quantum leap, leading the next quantum revolution. We now know all these exotic quantum properties, squeezing and tunneling and more, and how by investigating those in a very basic research sense, we can have a revolution as profound as the first quantum revolution that led to all our electronic devices. And the big question of how quantum mechanics, quantum physics interacts with gravity. And I know some of the students, in fact, one of the winners of the prizes this morning is on this frontier. And then finally, among the big research ideas, one called Windows on the Universe. And this is taking advantage from the ground of the fact that we now have many different media for observing the universe. And they all observe very different properties of the universe. For example, in particle physics, we have neutrino detectors. I mentioned the one at the South Pole, and of course the detectors at CERN, and other neutrino detectors. We have a lot of electromagnetic telescopes everywhere around the world, many of them of which we construct and run. And then, of course, the gravitational wave, the third medium, revealing binary black holes. Who would have thought? I mean, the kinds of information that can be gotten from these different media is all very different and gives us new information that we can address the big mysteries of the universe, like the mass and the content of 95% of the mass energy of the universe. So it's a thrilling prospect to think how we can use all those facilities to work together in tandem. And then we have four process ideas, and let me mention more about those in just a minute. So we can group the six research ideas, and we didn't go into this retreat, mind you, deciding there should be six of this and four of that. We simply went in there thinking, what are the big things that NSF should be investing in? And they fell into these categories just very naturally. So these three big ideas we put in a category of pushing the boundaries of knowledge, because we stand on the threshold of a number of revolutions, as I said, in quantum mechanics and understanding the cosmos, understanding the rules of life. So here we picture a world in which we can forecast how life will respond and adapt to our ever-evolving planet. And we imagine a future where we don't have to worry about providing a safe and stable food supply despite changing environmental conditions. We imagine a world in which neurodegenerative disease is no longer a concern, or where environmental cleanup using bioengineered organisms is cheaper and faster than mechanical means. So advances in technology and knowledge have led us to the threshold of these frontiers, and we believe we need increased investment in basic research to realize their promise. So whether our funding moves toward the investigation into dark matter and dark energy, particular mysteries I'd like to address, or supports a scientific team that discovers a new kind of bioluminescent sensor for individual brain cells that help track brain interactions with enlarged neural networks, or exploits quantum properties of squeezing and tunneling and entanglement to bring about quantum communication and computing, quantum simulations and sensors, it's really imperative that we continue to lead the way when we push the boundaries of scientific discovery. The second area that three of our big ideas fall into is what we call seizing new opportunities. And we can do this, again, because of new technology that's opened up new frontiers. So the increased volume and variety and velocity of data that we can now capture offers opportunities to better understand our world and accelerate scientific discovery. So you all know that the big data revolution is underway and is transforming all the content parts of research, all of our science and engineering research. And the data deluge is producing its own challenges. And this, we think, requires a bold national scale solution with new approaches to data science and cyber infrastructure and balancing privacy and openness. That's going to be a continuous challenge for us. And so here we want to have as much impact as we did when we created NSFNet way back when in the early 1990s, and just a few universities were joined, and then that became the internet. And we think that the whole cyber infrastructure is due for another revolution like that that will create more opportunities for data science. Similarly, the rapid warming of the Arctic, it's warming at twice the rate of the rest of the planet, poses both human and environmental challenges as well as opportunity. So there's a newfound accessibility in the Arctic due to melting sea ice and permafrost, and that offers new opportunities for scientific research on climate change, as well as new opportunities for the private sector. This is a reality that hasn't escaped the attention of other Arctic nations. Recently, we had at the White House an Arctic Science Ministerial in which we, 40 countries, ministers of science from 40 countries of the world talked about the challenges and opportunities in the Arctic. We have to race to make sure that we're there. So our vision is to document the rapid changes in the Arctic, which I think you know provide a big feedback cycle for climate change worldwide, by building out a dense network of sensors across Alaska. We're going to utilize new technologies to make this goal cheaper, like 3D printing. Now you can 3D print towers. In fact, I think many of you don't know that in Zambia, we have worked through NCAR, the National Center for Atmospheric Research that we fund, with the country of Zambia to establish towers all over the country that are 3D printed, these giant towers, to do weather-related observations. So it's amazing to think that how technology has provided us with cheaper ways of doing things like sampling. We can also use autonomous vehicles like drones to do faster and cheaper measurements of changes in the land and ocean and atmosphere to collect and distribute precision data with high time and spatial resolution. There's additional technologies I lightly mentioned, like gene editing, genetically modified foods, artificial intelligence, machine learning. In fact, technology is really reshaping everything that we do and the way that we're working. And so yesterday I spent some time at Google with their folks that are working on the future of work. And maybe some of you have seen Laszlo's books on the future of work, which he's tried at Google, making it a very interesting place to work. We want to explore with places like that that are working on the future of how artificial intelligence and robots are being used to collaborate with workers rather than displace them. And then the last collection of big ideas we call our process ideas. And this is really represents these ideas that NSF is basically an agency that tries to help other big ideas. And it tries to help with researchers like yourselves to realize your vision, what you want to do. And we recognize that we have obstacles that impede impede that process. And so these represent four of them that we think are just ripe and that we can really do something about. So I will quickly mention them and what they're about. NSF includes is about broadening participation to people that are underrepresented in the United States to get them into science and engineering. We fund 40 pilot programs. We just funded them. And this afternoon, I'll be in the LA area with the Cal State Community College head, who will collect all the includes investigators locally to find out exactly how they're doing that. But what we asked was for innovative proposals that would be reaching out in new ways to broaden participation, because frankly, we haven't moved the needle very much in the country on that. Down below on the left, we call this initiative mid-scale research infrastructure. I think some of you have experienced, LIGO would be a great example, that we fund very expensive things that cost $100 million to $1 billion, and we fund very inexpensive things like maybe some of the spectroscopes and other equipment of a couple million dollars in your laboratories. But we have a big gap, represented by that gap in a bridge, where we don't fund projects that are between $10 million and $100 million. And that's just an artifact of, well, we've always done it that way. But now technology has put a lot of interesting research, including a lot of computer architectures, in that gap, and sensors for telescopes and chips and other things. And so we are reaching for further investment in order to offer the community opportunities to propose there. Convergence, moving over to the bottom right, is a new method, maybe not new for Caltech, but it would have been new from when I was a graduate student, where you have scientists and engineers from all disciplines all working together on very specific problems to approach grand challenges. And we recognize that that's tough to do because we don't have the merit review processes. In fact, we actually have processes that discourage those kind of proposals from having a careful review, and then we're not good at collecting reviewers to do them. So without we've identified those obstacles, and we will be launching new opportunities for truly convergent research, like the kind that you'd find in centers that are really well established, where you bring together computational biologists and theoretical physicists and engineers or clinicians to solve specific problems. But this will really represent a change internally for how we review and award proposals. And then finally, NSF 2050, looking ahead to our centennial in 2050, how should we fund the newest, most creative ideas that could come from anywhere that don't really belong within our specific directorates, which in spite of all of our attempts to work across them are still stovepiped in some sense. And so we are creating a common fund that we hope that Congress and others will fund, including foundations join with us to fund really novel, transformative ideas. So that's the sum of, and very briefly, overview of what where we're going and how we think about our future and the opportunities for future investment. And so I just want to close with a couple of things for the students themselves, because I know that this audience probably has a lot of students in it and postdocs, that we need to really realize the nation's potential for innovative science more than just consistent and robust funding, that we need students and postdocs like yourselves who are at the beginning of their careers to make a commitment to that this is very important, and to help us reach out and to communicate the value of basic research and to engage people in the stories of what you're doing. So I encourage you to expand your own horizons of what is considered possible and entertain your own big ideas about what many would regard as impossible or nearly so. That's the lesson of LIGO. It's the lesson of all great discoveries. It's the lesson of real progress in science. At my PhD commencement at Caltech, the speaker was the Nobelist Linus Pauling, told us, don't just have one big idea, have many big ideas. So I encourage, challenge all of you to have many big ideas. Thank you very much for your attention.
I'm wondering how you foresee
Those are probably two pretty different things. So we have no idea in a new administration, but we're always hopeful, right? And I think we do have a very supportive Congress. One of the people who's talking with the new administration is a former legislator, Newt Gingrich, and he says that his one regret was that when Congress doubled the NIH budget, that they didn't double the NSF budget. And he's repeated that many times. I know at the beginning, when President Obama came in, he said one of his goals was to double the budget. But of course, we hit a plateau with funding constraints. But who knows? The next administration could have a very different idea of how we can invest in all important science and technology. I think we have a supportive Congress that we've worked very closely with, and they really like most of what NSF is doing. And that brings me to the second part of your question. I said most of. Okay, so the difference in administrations could be, I'm not saying that it will necessarily be, but it could be where priorities are set. Because usually a president and White House comes in and they have their goals for science. So President Obama had the BRAIN Initiative, Advanced Manufacturing and Computer Science for All, many things that really our agency was very responsive to, and we got on board with. We really developed, I mean, brain science, just think of how far it's come in the past few years with that impetus. So that's the kind of magic that an administration that locks on to an idea of the time and engages all the agencies to follow suit, and likewise foundations and others. We don't know where this administration's priorities will be. I will say, to the credit of our appropriator, that our House appropriator and the Senate appropriations, that they have resisted changing up the funding for one discipline in NSF compared to another. There were threats of that because they thought maybe some science had a higher priority than others. But I think the science community helped us very effectively make the case that in meeting grand challenges, it could be just the kind of science that you don't think is important, the social and behavioral scientists or the computational biologists or the theoretical physicists, that actually is the glue that will make that project, will solve that mystery. And we have many great examples, including a recent one that NSF funded in the Stand Up to Cancer Initiative, where we funded an effort on pancreatic cancer that brought together just those people, theoretical physicists and computational biologists, with clinicians. And we would have never gotten as far in that research as they have without it being a very convergent approach that depended on all sorts of different people. So to the extent that you all have examples like that of research that would not have been done unless you brought together people from different disciplines, I think that argument will really weigh in the favor of not disturbing the funding of one discipline at the expense of another in an effort to keep the budget exactly constant.
Other questions?
Hi, my name is Daniel Lee. I'm a postdoc neuroscientist here. And the NSF, my question is, the NSF is one of a unique organization that's funded several different scientific disciplines, unlike the NIH, and has a real record of funding convergent history. There's examples here. One of the challenges in neuroscience, and I think it's because of the incentive structures, is that it tends to be more siloed at the university setting.
Yeah.
And what are your thoughts, and what are the NSF's actions towards...
Take all my little parts
towards,
with me.
conveying programs or action towards getting neuroscientists who work on these grand ideas to talk to each other more, to work together, and to change underlying, I guess, incentive structures towards convergence?
Well, it's a great question and very timely one, because I think things are really changing for neuroscience. I completely agree with your picture, and that's been the way it was. But because of a new or renewed emphasis on neuroscience, not only nationally but internationally, we've been able to work with partners like the Kavli Institute that funds neuroscience and host workshops, and a recent one was at Rockefeller University, hosted by Corey Bargman there. Did anybody go to that? So you were there. So why are you asked? No. It was such a great example, because everybody there said, did you stay to the end when the conference organizers got the standing ovation? So people said it was the best neuroscience conference ever. And that's because of exactly what you're talking about, of people getting together in a discipline that wasn't used to getting together. And so, you have to take baby steps. Maybe some other disciplines have been doing that for a very long time. And I think the neuroscientists were so thrilled that they had that opportunity. And as you know, it was a collection of industry and academia and foundations. And then it was topped off that evening where some of us went to the United Nations, where they held a special session. And I and the head of Kavli got to host these panels with ministers from around the world talking about brain science. None of them are brain scientists, but don't tell them. They all want to support brain science. That's the important thing there. So I think it is a new day for neuroscience, and there's just a lot of momentum there. So I'm glad you were there.
Okay, we'll just take a couple more questions here. I'm Hillary from the postdoc. You mentioned that the NSF has had trouble moving, or not the NSF particularly, but had trouble moving the needle in terms of diversity in science. What do you think, the NSF has had this as part of their mission for many, many years.
Yes.
So when
I came in there, we do a lot of statistical analysis. In fact, we have a whole national center for statistics in science and engineering, NCSES, that produces every 2 years with the National Science Board the science and engineering indicators. And so it's all very scientific, so we can actually understand where we are. And as I said, we, in spite of spending a lot of money and having programs like the Advance Program at universities to advance the careers of women, and the Lewis Stokes Minority Alliance Participation Program that has been so beneficial to African-American students, and a number of programs like that, and Joan Freeney Munda here knows all about those programs because they're all in her domain, that we felt that the situation in the country was that there were just loads and loads of people that were left that still didn't have access into science and engineers in their schools and communities, and were without the exposure to it. And I was one of those students. And we were actively discouraged from taking the place of guys in our physics class when I was going to high school. So I understand that exposure and access to science and engineering is just so critical in tapping into that resonance that you have, that little magic that as a young girl when you look up in the night sky and say, oh my gosh, I wish I knew about that. That is amazing. And so to reach those, we started this program called INCLUDES. That's an acronym which means what it says. And we invited proposals from all over the country, and we got immediately overnight 600 of them, and we selected 40. And they are all what we call collective action proposals that consist of collaborations between communities and universities, sometimes community colleges, and they have very innovative kind of high-risk creative ways of approaching inclusion. And so I mentioned I was in the Bay Area, and we gathered the, mind you, they'd just been funded, so they're all just starting out. And this afternoon I'll see the LA ones. But they, for example, one is in, has a computer science kind of theme, and led by a computer scientist. And he has taken many of the programs that they already do, and he's putting them all together with this from pre-K through 6, and then middle school, and then high school, and on up to age 20 or so. He's putting all those programs together with a computer science overlay and doing a lot of different types of engagement and mentorship to bring in people to keep the continuity and to keep kids from leaving, and encourage their continuous mentoring. But that's only one example, and I'm sure if you wanted to talk with Joan after this session, she can give you a number of other examples. I am actually the team leader of this initiative because I feel so passionately about it, and I'm hoping that our emphasis on innovation and risk-taking in this domain will yield some pilot programs that we can broadcast widely on the net. And then the next step will be to go to alliances where we ask the different pilot programs to join with each other in areas where it looks like it makes sense, and we'll give more funding for that. But we intend to try to knock off this, you know, this problem, and to have some replicable, scalable solutions to broadening participation. That's a, you know, maybe a pie in the sky, but you have to reach for it, and we're willing to put in some money. And I think it's tremendous that we have university presidents and vice presidents, heads of the head of the whole community college system is the one that's organized this thing for this afternoon. So everybody feels that we need to do something differently, and now we're coming up with some ideas about what that actually means.
Okay, we'll take one more question. I think we have one here. Yeah.
So I'm an undergraduate senior currently applying for grad school, and I was wondering why doesn't the NSF Graduate Research Fellowship fund international students study in the U.S.?
Well, so I have two comments about that. One is we do fund as a supplement our graduate student fellows to do our graduate student fellows in this country to go abroad and to have a year abroad. And in fact, this student that was in the news recently, who kind of discovered in the pictures evidence of water on Mars, was one of the students that we funded. But we do not fund, all of our money goes to US participants or people working in this country. We do not fund other countries. We do a lot of collaboration with other countries, and LIGO would be one excellent example, but there are hundreds, thousands of them. But they fund their students and their faculty, and we fund ours. And it's just Congress has insisted for NSF that we have a no exchange of funds. But we spend a lot of time going to other countries and talking about our programs. And they will, like our PIRE program, which is Partnerships in Research and Education, which we have with many countries, we will send over a bunch of students and faculty, and they will do the same thing with us. And I visited, and those collaborations seem to work very well. Did I explain what you do okay, Joan? I didn't mess it up. All right, good, good. Well, thank you all very, very much for your attention.